Good evening. I'm John Batchelor. This is the John Batchelor Show, the end of the world. In China and in the United States, happening simultaneously. The two worlds are over. I feel pretty good for a person who's post-organic. Mary Kissel of the Wall Street Journal joins me tonight. Mary has her own show at Opinion Journal at WSJ.com each day at 1 p.m. Mary, the world ended today. We're feeling spry tonight. Is that a good thing that we've outlasted the rest of reality with the decline in the stock market in the United States and these alarming reports from China that they're either out of money or nobody will lend money anymore? Good evening, Mary.
Good evening, John. I think we survived today, but the real question is, are you going to survive tomorrow and next week and next month? Because it's sure going to be rocky.
We welcome the turmoil as we welcome Patrick Trevanek of Silvercrest Asset Management. Patrick was many years in China, and last night at midnight, Mary, I caught him tweeting at midnight. And Patrick, be warned, never do that because I'm on the air. When I saw that, I said, call him up, let's go, let's do this. Because last night at about, sometime between 11 and 12 o'clock East Coast time, Australia, I'm talking East Coast time now, not for you, it was afternoon for you. The interbank rate in Shanghai went to 25%, which Patrick interpreted, a shorter version of this, nobody was lending money to nobody suddenly. And you depend upon overnight lending between banks called repo to pay your bills, to finance your ongoing operations. And also for banks, this is a way of earning a small amount of money each day. But it stopped last night at 25%. Nobody was borrowing money. Patrick, the world ended today. How's it doing tonight in China? Can we anticipate? Are the Chinese going to flood their markets with money as they did 2 weeks ago, or are they going to be chary and make everybody suffer? Good evening, Patrick.
Good evening. Well, we're going to have to find out. I think a lot of people who never heard of SHIBOR before, which is the overnight rate in Shanghai, are going to be paying close attention to it today and where it ends up. And we'll find out whether the PBOC, the central bank in China, intervenes either selectively or massively to try to provide banks with cash, or whether they let them twist in the wind. And I think a lot of people are eager to know the answer to that question.
Patrick, when you say twisting in the wind, does that mean not just the big four state banks, but also that big shadow banking sector that isn't a part of the formal economy? I mean, the Chinese central bank isn't going to step in and prop up those guys, are they?
Well, you know, I think that's the interesting part of that is how intertwined the shadow banking system is with the formal banking system in China. They're not two separate entities. Really, it's almost like the banks in China have a hidden balance sheet in which part is, you know, visible to us, and part of it is in the form of the shadow banking system. And I think that's one of the reasons why we've seen credit seize up in China, is that the shadow banking system and the formal banking system are not really two separate entities. They're tied together.
I'm going to follow the Wall Street Journal, the rosy scenario. Mary, we're going to do the China's credit crunch is good for humanity version of the story here. Patrick, I'm just going to try this, all right? I'm running the flag up and see what happens. That the credit crunch, the interbank lending rate, the spike, all of that is a sign that China now appreciates the fact that you can't run independent of the laws of economics and the way bubbles work forever, and that they're ready to take the pain in order to correct their excesses in the past. Do you accept that, Patrick? Are they growing up very quickly now with a new leadership in Beijing?
Okay, so the Wall Street Journal had an editorial along those lines, saying that the good news, the silver lining of this, was that reform is coming and that the PBOC is serious about getting lending under control. There's an element of truth to that. There is an element where you know, I always said that you would know that the Chinese were serious about reform when there were real defaults that took place and real losses that were recognized. The trick, though, is that I think the Chinese have waited so long to address these issues that they've painted themselves into a corner. And the correction that's going to take place is so severe that it could be, you know, there's real systemic risk of a domino effect, that the assumption is that everything's guaranteed. You pull away that assumption and you have, you know, many banks fail, many investment instruments fail. And I think that's the challenge right now for the PBOC is that they've really got the bull by the horns. You know, to try to rein in credit growth at all, or even just dial it back, involves a real high wire act of not pushing the banks, or even, you know, the entire banking system into default. So, you know, it's I understand why the PBOC is trying to rein in credit. I can understand why they may be pulling the plug on even short-term liquidity, but it's going to take a lot of nerve to go through that and find out what's on the other side of that, because it's pretty scary.
We're reporting now the Nikkei is down 2%, the Hang Seng down 3%. They're just opening. The markets are just opening. Go ahead, Mary.
Well, Patrick, we've had quite a bit of turmoil here in the United States. How much of that affects the Chinese banks, if at all? Or are Chinese banks really just all about China, and that's all that the PBOC actually has to worry about, are the happenings within mainland China itself?
You know, there's a view that's been put forward that this is really about Fed QE tapering, and that, you know, there were hot money flows into China that were encouraging liquidity or creating liquidity, and now that's unwinding now, and that it's causing a liquidity a lack of liquidity in China. I think that there's a story there that's real. I don't think it's necessarily the dominant story. This is really a homegrown issue that arises from China's credit-fueled investment boom over the past 5 years, and the stresses that has placed in terms of not only financing more new investment every year, but also refinancing or papering over losses from bad debt and trying to roll bad debt over, and that has placed such a stress on the banking system in China that it's, you know, there is not enough credit, I think that's the dominant story. But there was there was over the past few months a carry trade that took place where Chinese companies would borrow in dollars. They would bring those dollars into China in the form of faked export invoice receipts, and that's one of the reasons why Chinese exports, you know, suddenly fell off when they cracked down on that.
HSBC reporting a decline in manufacturing for the second month, going on to 48 and change, and that's the real economy, Patrick. So this is not just about bad banking and falsehood. This is also about the fact that China is now suffering what we're all witnessing, which is a slowdown in consumer spending.
Right. No, I mean, and you're absolutely right. I mean, one of the reasons why the PMI or manufacturing is contracting in China really is because, well, what's falling off in China is demand for heavy equipment for construction, steel, things like that really have been feeding China's investment boom. And why is China's investment boom falling off? It's because there's not enough financing in the banking system to fund all the investments that China would need to drive investment-led growth.
Detail here. Mary, I just ask you, was there a sense of panic today, you're reading, because you were 6 years in Asia. Did you perceive panic, or did you see that this was well prepared, that people have been writing about this for some time? So there was a sense of, yes, it's happening now, but this is not unexpected.
I think people expected some sort of reckoning, John. I don't think that they necessarily expected it today, although there was a lot of attention on the Fed announcement, which I'm sure perhaps drew more eyeballs to what was going on in the Far East.
But right now, Patrick, you're not linking directly Mr. Bernanke's very careful remarks 24 hours ago to the interbank crisis that we're seeing in China right now. The reporting, by the way, is that the PBOC, that's the central bank, the People's Bank of China, that's the Communist Party, they're putting money into the system in some fashion. So you don't link those two directly. Is that correct, Patrick?
Yeah, I think that, you know, Fed QE may have caused some hot money inflows that are now, you know, coming back from China. But that, you know, that carry trade was sort of icing on the cake, and okay, it wasn't the main story.
Patrick Chovanec of Silvercrest Asset Management, Mary Kissel, host of Opinion Journal each day at 1 p.m. at WSJ.com. I'm John Batchelor.